In this video, I'm going to explain to you what exactly is Kubernetes. I'm going to answer some very basic questions like, what problem does Kubernetes solve? How did it come into existence? Why is it such a big deal? What are the use cases? And should you be using Kubernetes or not?
But you should already be familiar with Docker, or at least the concept of containerization.
You can check out my YouTube playlist on Docker to learn more about that. Welcome to the first lesson of Kubernetes from Zero to Hero. My name is Raghav. Let's get started. Let's start from the very beginning. We were cavemen who discovered fire. Then, after thousands of years of scientific progress, we built a backend application for our website. We called it Monolith. One monolithic application would do everything, but it became hard to scale.
Gradually, we started to break these monoliths down into much smaller and more focused applications that we called microservices. Each microservice does one thing and is independently scalable. Next, we wanted to run these applications on different computers without any dependency issues, so we started packaging them into containers.
As some of these applications got bigger, they faced a very interesting challenge.
The number of microservices increased to handle more types of tasks. The number of servers each microservice was deployed to also increased to handle the growing scale. In addition to production, people also wanted to run these containers in other environments like dev and staging.
Suddenly, they were running tens of thousands of containers in their infrastructure.
How do you manage the lifecycle of so many containers?
Upgrading containers without downtime, auto-scaling resources based on load, managing access control of all services, communication amongst containers, troubleshooting when something goes wrong. There are just too many problems. This simply cannot be done manually or with some ad hoc scripts.
The problem of managing a very large number of containers in your infrastructure is called container orchestration. Kubernetes is a container orchestrator. It ensures that all the services in your infrastructure are running smoothly according to your desired state. The way it works is,
a Kubernetes cluster sits on top of your entire infrastructure and controls all your resources, such as compute, storage, networking, etc. This cluster is usually set up and administered by a DevOps or a platform engineering team. A developer creates an application and packages it into a container image. Next, they ask Kubernetes to run containers using this image. They submit the desired state to Kubernetes, who then deploys the containers to servers and provides them with the necessary resources based on all the requirements and constraints. This way, Kubernetes runs applications with high availability and scalability and helps manage these containers.
Where did Kubernetes even come from?
Back in early 2000, Google had created an internal cluster management system called Borg. It was used to run tens of thousands of workloads for them.
In 2014, Google released an open-sourced container orchestration tool called Kubernetes, which was heavily influenced from the design of Borg. This was a time when containers were already starting to become mainstream, thanks to Docker. So developers were out there already looking for orchestration solutions. Google then worked with the Linux Foundation to create the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, where Kubernetes was the seed project. Why is Kubernetes such a big deal? Kubernetes quickly became the most popular choice for container orchestration solutions.
It is very cutting-edge technology with a massive community and backing from the largest tech companies in the world.
Almost every major tech company hiring for software and DevOps engineers are looking for some sort of experience with Kubernetes, and they pay good money. As of today, every major cloud provider has a Kubernetes offering. This makes it a lot more accessible, and so more and more companies are adopting it as they embrace containerization.
So naturally, everyone is talking about it.
But should you use Kubernetes or not? Kubernetes automates a lot of your infrastructure, but that comes at a price. If you're running your own Kubernetes cluster, it has a huge operational overhead attached to it. Even if you're using a cloud-managed offering, you still need a dedicated team that understands Kubernetes, so they can scale and operate the cluster in production.
When things break, you need to be able to troubleshoot through layers and layers of this monster to fix the issues.
So, Kubernetes only truly shines if you're operating at a large scale.
You should have at least a few thousand containers to manage in production to get a net gain from it.
Companies like Google, Booking, Netflix, Shopify, and Slack use Kubernetes to manage hundreds of thousands of containers in their infrastructure. Companies like OpenAI also use Kubernetes to run tens of thousands of containers. This is usually to run their microservices or train AI models, run some big data workloads, and so on.
But if you're just doing a side project or are an early stage startup focused on just shipping your product to a few customers, customers, you don't have the scale for Kubernetes. Don't waste your time on it. If your entire web app is powered by one monolithic backend and everything is stable, Kubernetes is an overkill. Even when you've hit the limits of scaling your monolith vertically and horizontally, consider breaking it into serverless functions like Lambda before you move to a full-fledged microservices architecture. If your microservices are running fine with just 400 to 500 containers, you're still better off using a fully managed container service like AWS ECS.
But if you're truly beyond the scale, then you need a better container management strategy, and Kubernetes is probably a great tool for you.
With a good strategy, you can use Kubernetes for pretty much all your infrastructure needs. Running microservices, cron jobs, big data workloads such as Spark jobs, GPU workloads, even data stores like Kafka and MySQL. But don't be a fanboy. Don't use Kubernetes just because it's the hot thing today. You will pay a heavy price, and it's probably not a good long-term solution for your small-scale product.
Trust me.
So you can probably start to imagine how big of a system Kubernetes really is. This is why I'm going to break this monster down into a series of smaller videos that I'm going to keep adding to my playlist.
These videos focus on teaching specific concepts through projects. And here's what you're going to learn. If you're still watching this video, you have already been introduced to Kubernetes. There is no going back. Next is Kubernetes architecture and how its key components interact with each other. Then you're going to see how to run Kubernetes on your local machine using Minikube. Once we get it running, we'll go with the tradition of deploying a Hello World application on Kubernetes. After that, it's going to be a deep dive into networking concepts of Kubernetes. Package management using Helm, then we deploy a production-grade microservice to Kubernetes. This will be followed by setting up a production database for the microservice that we deploy. And then finally, you'll see how to do monitoring and logging for Kubernetes applications.
Excited? Me too. Now, I want you to tell me,
what are some alternatives to Kubernetes and how are they different from it?
Let me know your answer in the comments. In the next video, I'm going to explain to you the architecture of Kubernetes and how its key components interact with each other. Keep leveling up your game with me. It takes a lot of effort for me to create these videos. So if you found them useful, please show me your support. Like, share, subscribe, become a DevOps pro. See you next time.